Well, good morning, City on Your Family. How are you guys doing this morning? There's five people in the room. No, there's lots of people in the room. How are you doing this morning? It's wonderful, friends. Friends, it's an opportunity for us again to continue the second installment in our Living the Dream series. And we're looking at the life of Joseph. And last week, Mark did just a phenomenal job of launching this series for us. Who enjoyed the message from Mark last week? It was so beautiful, so encouraging, just being able to be reminded again that God is the one who gives dreams. And ultimately, our purpose is found not in our ability to chase one moment in time, but actually that it's a lifetime. And that all of us, our lives, the dreams, the opportunities, the platforms, the accolades, all the things we would aspire to, all of those things are actually aimed at one thing and one thing only. It's to glorify God and to live for Him and Him alone. And the different areas and elements that we'll be working through in this series, I think God's going to help us to see, as we would look at the life of Joseph, just how that actually impacts our lives. And many of us, I'm sure many of us, if you've heard the story, you've checked the narrative, you remember being in Sunday school maybe at some point in your life and somebody shared about it. But I also realize that many of us are not so familiar with that story. Do you realize that we are today the most connected generation and people ever, but we know the least amount? Because people are not reading their Bibles, and they're not praying. They're not trusting God. They're not communing with God. And I'm sure many of you here today, you maybe have come today, and this is the first and maybe possibly the only moment you would have had moment of worship, prayer, and being able to hear God's word being spoken. Can I encourage you that God has got a lot more for you and for me? That we can actually walk in a lot more, and God would want to empower us, that we would be able to not only know some of the stories in the Bible and say, oh, that's something I remember, but actually that God is speaking to us individually. And so I wanted to take a moment to pray for us. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you for every person that's hearing me today, Lord. I think of even those of us that are gathered online, Lord Jesus. I'm thinking of those who are spread out all over the world and that are connected with us this morning, just spending some time praying for Dustin and for Sarah down in Newcastle, Lord, who's ordaining another eldership couple into the Bridge Church. Lord, we think of Mark and Marie in Charlotte. We think of Albie and Tracy that's sent from us. Busy planning a church in Finland right now. If we think of Nevson in Zimbabwe, we think of the Texera family in Langebaan and the people that are gathering together with them there. Lord, we thank you that you are sending us. Lord, we even pray for Murdoch as he's ministering in Germany right now, Lord. We think and thank you, Lord, that you are raising within us as a church a people of purpose, a people who would seek to fulfill your dream, not for our individual calls, but actually for your glory and for your kingdom, because that is what we are living for, Lord. And I pray that as I share this morning, we would hear what the Holy Spirit is wanting to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. So friends, if we talk about a dream, I'm not talking about, you know, something by and by or something unrealistic. I have a dream to play like, you know, Peter Steph the toy, who could jump over a bunch of Argentinian players yesterday. If you watched the highlights, that's all I got to see of the game. But to be able to score a try, or you like Jason Kobe, you can just be like a hot knife through butter when he's running through different people, you know, on the field. Many of us have dreams, and we think of it as sort of a pie in the sky kind of thing. I'm not talking about that kind of dream. I'm also not talking about a dream that we would look for a moment in time, but actually the dreams that God's talking about is actually something that impacts eternity. It's actually beyond our lives. And yesterday or last week, Mark mentioned to us this speech by Martin Luther King Jr., who said that I have a dream. Now, that dream he had wasn't for the American dream of a picket fence, a dog, and a vacation twice a year. The money in the bank and, you know, retire comfortably. That wasn't the dream that Martin Luther had. The dream he had was for reconciliation and transformation of a nation. And that dream, as he spoke it, he didn't really see it come to fulfillment in his lifetime because he was assassinated before he could see it come to pass. But today, the whole world knows about that dream. And many, many countries and nations, even ourselves, have been impacted and been transformed by that dream. So when we think about the dreams that God has, it's far-reaching. Jesus' dream for us is not that we would just, you know, get saved and be on our way to heaven. and just have a moment so that we could just live a comfortable life, a life filled with all the trappings of what the world may bring, but actually it's a life that brings God glory and that seeks to bring others into the knowledge of Him. Because Jesus is the author, in other words, He's the initiator. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. He's the one who starts it, but He also is continuing to perfect it. He's the one that gives, He births a dream, but then He also sustains it to its completion. And this is His dream. He says, who for the joy set before Him, what was that joy? The joy that you and I would come to know Him, to walk with Him in this life as well as in the life to come. And that was said before, He endured the cross. Jesus was willing to go through some hardship and trials, even death on a cross, the most excruciating pain and death anyone could experience, despising His shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus saw beyond His current circumstances. And today I'm speaking to us about how do you and I keep the dream alive. Keeping the dream alive is really important because many of us have moments. I have moments that I can think back at my life where I've had some really significant dreams. And I thought, Lord, this is what You've promised over me. It's not only just dreams I had as I was sleeping or dreams when I was praying, but actually many people, strangers even, have come up to me at times and confirmed and affirmed something of God's purpose. And they wouldn't know anything about me. But what's interesting to see about God's purpose and plan as He reveals it to us on an ongoing basis, there's always a recurring theme. Have you been picking up on the theme of God's purpose over your life? Because too many of us, I believe, don't walk in the purposes of God because we're seeking to live out someone else's dream. We miss out on the purposes of God because we're impatient. We miss out on the purposes of God, as we'll see in my message today, because of some of the circumstances and people and even the enemy's work in our lives, because we become impatient, because all we're looking for and we're looking to are the dreams of others. And when we think about dreams, friends, like I said, I'm not talking about becoming famous. In this world that we live in today, young people, if you ask them, what do you want to become one day? They will say, I want to become a YouTube influencer. Give me an Instagram page. Let me get famous on TikTok. All I need is that one breakthrough. But as many of us know, if you and I, any of us actually in this room, would win the lottery, hopefully you're not playing the lotto, okay? But hypothetically speaking, you did. If you won the lotto, statistically, it shows that within 5 years, you will be poorer than you were before you won the lotto. Why is that? Because we've never learned to actually sustain and grow and manage and steward what we have. And so when we're entrusted with a whole lot, we don't have the character. We don't have the skill. We don't have the ability to sustain that. That's why often dreams take a time and a while to come through in our lives. And so in the world that we live in today, we do often think about, I want to become famous. I want to ascend to a big platform. But friends, as many of us have experienced, and I'm sure you know this already, but there's only a smaller percentage of people that could become the president of our nation. There's only a small percentage of people. I had a friend who was he was aspiring to be a top tennis player. For him to get into the top 100 players of the world, he needed to become better than 10,000 other people that were all trying to get to the top 100 level. Now, he had skill, he had ability, he had resources behind him, but he never actually attained it. He ended up doing something else. And in saying that, I'm not saying that if that's what God's called you to and you're convinced and is affirmed by God, but let's be realistic about the dreams that we would pursue. Friends, because Winston Churchill said the following, success is not final and failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. And many of us, we measure our ability to walk in the purposes of God of our lives because of our failures. And many of us also stop growing because we've experienced some successes in our lives as well.
And can I say to you, if you're finding yourself in either one of those camps, can you and I be encouraged to continue because there's still more growth that needs to be happened, had in our lives? And there's also still some obstacles that will need to be overcome. All of us will experience disappointments in our lives. So what happens to us when we feel like the dream has died? What happens? I mean, Joseph comes, he has this dream, he eagerly shares it with his family, and they are not enthusiastic about it at all, so much so that they even sell him off into slavery. Many of us, you are feeling like, well, the minute God gave me a prophetic word, or there was a promise, or an idea, or a thought, when I started taking steps towards it, and I shared it with other people, everything started going wrong in my life, and I look back, and I feel like it's 2 or 3 or 5 or 10 or 20 years down the line. And now what? But friends, I want to encourage us today that God is more committed to the dreamer than he is to fulfilling the dream. This is important, friends. God wants to shape your and my heart in such a way that we would be able to carry, when it is entrusted to us, we would be able to carry the purposes of God. And as we know and see throughout the New Testament, when Jesus speaks to us, he says, you know, he entrusts talents to, you know, he tells the story about the master entrusting talents to his different servants. And when the master comes and receives an account, he said, you were a faithful steward with what I've given you, the little, but now I'm going to entrust you with much. In some of the parables, he actually says, I'm going to entrust you over cities. Friends, we are not just, heaven is not going to be somewhere on a cloud playing a harp. I just want to let you know. Some of you guys are like, thank goodness, because I can't play anything. God wants to you and I to understand that the skills and the character that he is building into us is not just for today, but will last beyond eternity. But what about the pain and the disappointments? What about those moments where you felt like everyone and everything has turned against you? Rick Warren says the following: God does not waste our pain. He uses it to mold us, teach us, and draw us closer to him. Here's the point of your dream, my friends. Your dream, the point of your dream is not to necessarily accomplish the dream. It's actually to become like Jesus. That is the pursuit. And what I've experienced, the more I seek to become like him, the more I look over my shoulder and I go, wow, Lord, I am living the dream. I'm living in your purposes for my life because I've faithfully given myself to your will. But what about the delays? I want you to know that God is in and he's with you in the delays. For Joseph, we see in Genesis 39, verse 1 to 2, it says, now Joseph had been brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard, an Egyptian, had bought him from the Ishmaelites, who had brought him down there. And this is the key. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became successful, and he was in the house of the Egyptian master. Friends, God is with you when there seems to be a delay. And can I want to challenge us. So often I lose sight of the dream. I lose sight of God, what God's doing in me, because I forget that God is actually with me. He's with me on the mountaintop, but he's also with me in the valley low. He is with us at every turn. You and I need to understand that and not look at our trials and our challenges as moments that we have been separated from God, but rather as moments that we can draw near to God, to come to know him, to walk with him. You've heard about the Chinese bamboo tree. It will be planted, and for 5 years, it needs to be watered every single day. But for 5 years, you and I don't see, it doesn't even break the ground. The seed does not appear at all. But after 5 years, within a number of days, it grows to over 20 meters high. Why do we see that? Friends, God is often working in the foundation, in the roots, so that it can sustain what God would want to bring about in our lives. And so when you and I experience delays, do not Do not forget that God is with you in the delays. Even during that times of delay, you and I can actually see the favor of God. You know, it is the favor of God even when we are not feeling like He's with us. When God sustains us in difficult times, it's a testimony. When people look at our lives and say, well, you've got these promises, you've got this purpose over your life, it's clear God's spoken these things, you actually are very gifted. There's a clear reality that this is where God's leading you, but the opportunities are just not coming your way. Then you and I need to understand that even in those times, people look at our lives, and if we living close to Him, we seek to honor Him and glorify Him, we will begin to shine before people for God's glory. And this happened with Joseph. It says in verse 3 of chapter 39 of Genesis, it says, when his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor. Too many times I listen to people who come to me, and this actually happened now, like yesterday, I was having a conversation with somebody who today is beginning to walk in a dream that they had. They shared that dream with me 7 years ago. And I remember sitting with them 7 years ago, and they explaining to me, this is what I want to see. This is what I want to, I believe God's called me. I've got these prophetic words. It's clear that this is going to happen. And I remember sitting with him 7 years ago and saying, listen, I think God still wants to work on you a little bit. And I think there's some preparation that God still wants to do. And I do remember sitting with him and saying, I remember the story of Joseph. It sounds to me like God's given you a dream and there's some time of preparation that needs to happen. And I do also remember at that time him saying to me 7 years ago, I don't believe that. That doesn't make sense. I'm not going to take that word. And then yesterday, he says to me, you know, 8 years ago, the Lord gave me a dream. And I'm so glad because I realize, looking back now, God's been working on me. He's been preparing me. He's been resourcing. He's been empowering me to be able to walk in what He's now, what He promised me 8 years ago. Friends, can I say to you that when God gives you a dream, trust the leaders and the people around you to help you to give shape, because God is more interested in your character than He is about your gifting or the platform or the opportunities that would come. And often we want to bypass the process. And so when we look at the favor that God would bring, when you and I stand before God and we are faithful, I've just seen this time and time again. Those who do not try and take hold of things for themselves, but in humility saying, Lord, I'm submitting myself to you. I want to serve you. I want to love you. I want to love your people. I want to give myself wholeheartedly to you, the purposes and plans that you have. Then, looking over their shoulders, you can see the favor and the hand of God's been upon them. God's provided for them. He's opened opportunities and doors. And then doors almost seem to open up from places where you wonder, where did this happen? How did this happen? I can't believe that this has happened. It's miraculous. But you and I often don't want to go through that process because we feel like God's delaying it. Some of the reasons why many people don't walk in the dreams and why their dreams die is because they give in to temptation. The shortcut, the opportunity. Let me actually bomb out. I mean, Joseph had this opportunity in verse 7 to 10. It says, and after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, lie with me. That is, you know, let's get jiggy with it. But he refused and said to his master's wife, behold, because my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge, he is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He doesn't say against my master. No. I'm submitted to someone higher than who I'm serving right now. You and I need to see this. And as she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not listen to her and to lay beside her or to be with her. Friends, you and I need to see this. I've experienced it in my own life. And you probably have experienced it. If you haven't, it's coming. I just want to warn you. Temptations are going to come. The enemy is going to come. People are going to come and give you an opportunity. Hey, listen, I heard you. I can see the gifting of God. Let me bypass it. I've in ministry, I don't know, some guys, you know, they get phone calls from people. You know, Mark and Marie, he had left the church here in Clarksdorp where he was preaching at least 6 times a week. Powerfully involved in schools, running a ministry, comfortable, things are working. He answers God's call because he's had a dream of planting a church called City on Hill Church, but then chose to take a period of preparation to base himself with Bruce McAlpine and them at Lighthouse Church. And you know, friends, for the first year of being in Johannesburg, he preached 6 times. In the entire year, he was driving around, taking Bruce's car to the panel beaters, knocking out walls, working and serving in a place, loving people, loving God, but understanding God was working on him. And there was a point where as he was doing these things and looking and saying, Lord, you know, Lord, I'm capable of more. I'm okay. I'm a little bit capable of a little bit more than what I'm doing right now. He got a phone call from a friend. He said, listen, Mark, we need a worship leader. You know, what salary you're getting right now? We'll up your salary, man. Your wife won't have to work. You can just come and lead worship. All you need to do is just lead worship. Just lead the three bands that we have. Just lead worship on a Sunday, and that's all we need from you. You don't have to put up. And Mark's like, yes, that sounds like amazing. This is an answer to prayer. Answer to my purpose. I mean, I don't have to go through that. And him and Bruce at that stage, he'll tell you, they were boxing. There were moments where Bruce was on his case about stuff. And Mark's like, listen, bro, like mind your own business here. But he chose to not take the bait. Not take the bait of offense. Can I maybe just go on a side here? Some of you, not walking in what God has for you because you're offended. You're offended because someone's overlooked you. You're offended because someone didn't appreciate you. You're offended because someone didn't look at you or they look at you real funny. I don't know. Afrikaans say, bou 'n brug en kom oor dit. In the most loving way I can say this, friends, get over it. Life is too short and it's the enemy's trap. Because what happens is, and this, I've seen this too many times, even in my own life, I've had to fight this. When I think, no, I'm gonna do it. What inevitably happens is, I get offended, and what do? I disengage from the very place that God has used and is using to bring me into the fullness of what He has for me. And then I, as a pastor, I'm just giving you guys a bit of a glimpse into my life with when people come and share their dreams with me. They share their dreams, and I'm excited, and I'm wanting to make opportunities and create platforms and invest in them, and maybe also correct them and challenge them on some areas. Like I had my friend 7 years ago, and he's hearing me say stuff that he doesn't want to hear. But then that person becomes offended and they disengage. Oh, the Lord's told me to take a break. I remember we were leading a church in Potchefstroom. We just transitioned, you know. I had the privilege of sharing at the Equip in Gauteng this week around transitions. And you know, before transitions happen, there's all the confirmations in the world. The Lord's in this. Yes, this is must happen. There's change of leadership. There's change. God's got more. A change has to happen. We've got dreams. We've got visions. We've got prophetic words. We've got scriptures. All of those things happen. Nobody says a negative thing and before the transition happens. Transition happens, and then all of a sudden, as we experienced in Potchefstroom, 7 people came to me in 1 week. All of them could play bass, and all of them said to me, the Lord's told them to take a break. And I was like, Lord, do you not like bass players? Sorry, do you know? But I mean, like, bass is from it's down low, so that's why we don't like it, you know? I don't know. Friends, I want to speak to you from the heart, friends. I've seen too many people disregard and discard the dreams and the purposes that God has for them because they've gotten offended. They couldn't deal with their own hearts. Can I encourage you? Deal with your heart. Allow God to actually heal you and bring you into more of what he has for you, because God is more interested in what's happening in your heart than he is about what you can do on the platform or what ministry you're leading or what platforms or opportunities you have or how much money you have in the bank or how successful you are. C.S. Lewis says, integrity is doing the right thing even when no one is watching. Friends, God wants us to be upright in heart and be secure in who we are. So don't allow the enemy to distract you. I've seen this too many times. Corrie ten Boom says, if the devil cannot make us bad, he will make us busy. I've seen this. Couples, the call of God is on our lives. We feel we want to serve. Gareth, I just want to serve. I want to lay down. I believe God's called me. And then they have a baby. And now, I'm not saying having a baby is a distraction. But they neglect the call of God because the baby's new sleeping rhythms is a little bit out of sync, so they can't make a prayer meeting or a light group, or they can't come to church and gather with the saints because, you know, the baby's got things. Or, yes, you know, people come forward month after month. Lord, pray for me for a job. I need a job. And they hear every single Sunday, and they pray for me for a job. And then God provides for them a job. And then what happens? They stop engaging because God somehow has now, their cosmic genie's been rubbed the right way. They got what they wanted. And they neglect. They discard the dream. They don't keep the dream alive. Friends, the enemy might not cause us to sin, but sometimes he makes us very busy. Very busy with a lot of stuff. And I've been challenged by this. I'm looking at my life and I'm saying, what things have I added into my life that's distracting me? That's keeping me from walking in what God has called me to. Because God has a great dream for each of us. When God has given us destiny, Joseph had great destiny, but he also experienced great opposition. The enemy will attack you and I. Because ultimately what he's looking to do is to kill, steal, and to destroy. He wants to kill, steal, and destroy from you, or sometimes he wants to use you to kill, steal, and to destroy in other people's lives. Don't fall for the enemy's trap. Don't allow the enemy to remove that from you, because he is, as we see in 1 Peter 5 verse 8, be alert. Be sober-minded. It's never God's plan. You know, I'm sharing a lot of stuff I wasn't preparing to say, but I believe the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. So many times I would justify, or I would want to say or share something that's in my heart that I feel is helpful, but I don't really love. I'll use my wife and I as an example. And you guys don't think I'm talking about you, but I'm just the two of us. Sometimes I want to share some things, and there's growth opportunities and there's blind spots I have, I can see. But because I don't really love her for what God has placed in her, and why I'm not really wanting to call out of her the purposes of God, actually what I'm looking for is what I would like to have. I would prefer it if she treated me like this, or if she spoke to me like this, or if she was a bit more like Jesus for me. Not for her, but for me. I would love Jesus more if she loved him more. So I share with her. I don't have a real love. I don't have genuine love for her. So many times we want to speak into people's lives or into situations. We make observations, but we don't really love the person. We're not calling out the gold, the purposes of God, because we're ultimately looking out for ourselves. And that's the enemy's schemes, friends. That is the enemy's work. And so he's prowling around. We must be sober-minded. He prowls around like a roaring lion. He wants to distract. He wants to bring division. I love this quote by T.D. Jakes, and the reason why I put it in is because I need to explain this. The greater your destiny, the greater your opposition. Now, like I said in the beginning, friends, when we talk about destiny, we often think about, oh, I want to be T.D. Jakes. That's what I want to be. Worldwide fame, multi-million dollar, whatever, you know, book, sells books, does all of these things. Friends, if you are called to raise children, that's a massive destiny. If you're a business owner and you're employing people and you're creating jobs and you're taking care of your workers, a great destiny. If you're a school teacher, and I know you're overwhelmed with all sorts of admin and frustrations, and nobody likes you, nobody cares for you, and nobody appreciates you, your destiny is great. And therefore, if you have a great destiny, that means each and every one of us, then the opposition is going to be great as well. Don't allow the enemy to distract you. You and I need to learn how to handle multiple disappointments if we're going to walk in and keep our dreams alive. Multiple disappointments. Oh, there's a promotion waiting for you. Just next year, the promotion is coming. You get overlooked. I hear people talk about this. I've got church hurt. You heard about church hurt. Basically, what that means is there was expectations and opportunities and platforms and things that you served and you worked hard and you sacrificed and you did all of those things. And at some point, you were overlooked. And you felt hard done by. Multiple disappointments. Friends, if you and I look at those disappointments as disqualifications, then we're never going to experience and walk in the dream that God has for us. We're never going to see it. Just settle in your heart that there will be disappointments. People will disappoint us. The world will disappoint us, but you know who will never disappoint us? God. Because if you and I use every opportunity, every disappointment, I've experienced it. I've had people hurt me to the core. And I thought, yes, you know, I remember you coming in. You told me, God told you that he sent you to help, to be helpful. And now you're not helpful. Or the Lord said you must go somewhere else. And I'm like thinking, is it God changed his mind now? What's happening? The dreams that God has gets derailed because of our disappointments. Don't put your hope in people. Put your hope in the Lord. Trust in him that he would lead you and me. I love this passage in Romans chapter 8. We love quoting it, and I've shared this on this before this year. It says, in verse 28, it says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. We love that. Like, Lord, you're going to take every hardship, every challenge, every disappointment, even the illness I'm experiencing, or the challenges in my relationships, or the financial struggle I'm going through, all of those things you're going to work for the good. But what is the context of what Paul's writing here? He's actually talking about us walking in the Spirit and becoming more like Jesus. And so the measure, if you want to look if things are going for the good, am I more like Jesus? Am I allowing the hardship I'm going through to make me more like Jesus? Because if I am becoming more like Jesus, even though my circumstances don't feel like that's so good, God is making me like his son, Jesus. He says in verse 29, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be what? Conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many. Those he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. It's about him. It's about his glory. It's about his kingdom. It's about his son and us becoming like him. That is how God works things for the good. It's not more money in the bank, even though that's helpful. It's not great relationships and everyone loves me. That's helpful, but it's ultimately, Lord, this is the question I always ask if I'm experiencing, and my wife and I have these conversations often. I'm like, Lord, I just don't feel like things are moving and I don't see it happening and I'm so frustrated because you've got these promises, Lord. Lord, I'm not like you yet. Work it for my good, because the best thing for me is to be more like Jesus. So you and I need to learn how to persevere. We've got to persevere. You've got to stay the course. We have been called to run a race. And last time I checked, this race never ends. Until Jesus comes back, that's when it ends. And then we've got new things to do. Heaven's going to be some work to be done. 2 Corinthians 4:16 to 18. So we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. I'm seeing this. I'm seeing it in people that are struggling with health challenges and circumstances in their life. They are continuing to contend because they're being transformed into the image of likeness of Christ. For this light and momentary affliction is preparing, again, friends, preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison as we look not to the things that are seen, but to that which is unseen, which is eternal. It is for His glory and His fame. So James says, I don't like James. I don't like James because he's so straight. He says this stuff. I'm like, ah, James, you're right. Consider it pure joy. Are you joyful in your trial? Are you joyful in persevering? Or are you murmuring and moaning? Well, when they apologize, when my breakthrough comes through, then I will. No. We continue to hold on. Because whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, let perseverance finish its work that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. That is the goal, friends. God wants us, as much as there will be opportunities and multitudes, I've had prophecies over my life of thousands and millions of people and beautiful realities, and I'm trusting God for that. But every single time I've experienced those things, I would look back and I go, Lord, I hope this isn't it, eh? I hope this wasn't like it. Now it's over. I've experienced what you promised. Now there's nothing left. I'll just have to wait until I die. That's how we live, friends. We're eagerly looking for the opportunities, the highs, instead of learning to continue to walk in God's ways by faith, not by sight. Walter Elliott says, perseverance is not a long race. Sure, some of you guys are like, great, that's awesome. No, it is many short races after the other. There are seasons in your life, you will see, where things pick up, and you feel like, oh man, this is good, I'm making progress, and then there's moments of resting. And resting doesn't mean I disengage. Resting doesn't mean I'm taking a break, Lord. No. Lord, what are you doing right now? If I'm resting, my muscles are also growing. I'm building capacity so that I could take on the next part of the race, that I would not lose sight of that which God has called me to. Friends, God's got a great dream for your life. He's got a great dream for this church, as we heard so beautifully shared with Amu. There's a sense of purpose and destiny in us as a people. And we can be so easily distracted, so easily tempted, so easily look to bypass the process of becoming more like Jesus. Can I say, if you've been saved for 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, or maybe even this morning, you would put your faith in Jesus, regardless of where we are on the journey, we need to continue to run the race. If God's placed gifts in your life, don't let it lie dormant. Don't allow your circumstances or the distractions or the busyness of life to say, I'm going to pause for a bit. No, Lord, I want to lean into what you're doing in my life. I want to see your purposes fulfilled in this generation. I want to see God fulfill all that He's promised. And therefore, I'm making every opportunity and taking every thought captive, and I'm waging a warfare, and I'm taking ground because I believe God's got a great dream for us, His people. There is more that God has for us, but it's going to require of us a willingness and a perseverance and a tenacity to stay the course, not allow the enemy to rob us or to keep us from what God has for us. Psalm chapter 5, verse 12. This is my last passage. He says, surely, Lord, you bless the righteous. You surround them with your favor as with a shield. The favor of God, when we are in the will of God, surrounds us. How do you and I know that we live according to the will of God? We just basically read the Bible and do what it says. That means we devote ourselves to prayer. We devote ourselves to fellowship. We devote ourselves to gathering together in temple courts and house to house. We devote ourselves to reaching out. We're not just spectators along the way and looking, oh, that's wonderful, because the body of Christ for too many years, friends, for decades and decades, the reason why the world isn't transformed yet is because we've become great spectators. We love watching the guys on the field and then commenting on what they should have done and how could you miss it. And that's what we do. We don't walk in what God has for us because we remain spectators. God wants us to engage, to begin to live the dream that he has for us. And so I want to ask you to stand with me as I pray for us. Holy Spirit, I thank you that you have highlighted many, many things to us, and even some of the things I shared today, I wasn't planning on sharing, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we would not be offended. We would not allow bitterness to take root, to defile us from what you have called us to. Lord, can we have the humility to repent? Friends, I don't know. I just feel like this is a holy moment right now. Even those of you that are watching online, I believe God wants you to deal with your heart. He's asking me to deal with my heart. Because I have opportunities to be distracted. I've got opportunities to be offended. But God, you want to work it for my good. That means I must become more like Jesus. I'm not like you, like Jesus, yet. None of us are yet, Lord. And so we submit ourselves. And friends, if that's you, just in this moment, I'm just going to give a moment of silence. Let the Holy Spirit deal with your heart. Lord, I thank you that you can change our heart in an instant, Lord. We might not feel like things have changed right now. I want to encourage you, if you've had to ask for forgiveness and repent right now, can I encourage you to remind yourself of the dream that God has, the dream of being like him, but also to be reminded that right now, from this moment onwards, you are no longer bound by the sin you were walking in, because it was sin. You're no longer bound by the opinions of others. You're no longer bound by the enemy's schemes that would not want to derail you from God's purposes. And that you can remind him and yourself when you feel like in moments to come that nothing's happened and things haven't changed and I've still got this stuff in my heart. Can I remind you to remind yourself and the enemy that it's been dealt with. It's finished. Jesus' blood has covered us of all sin when we repent. And so we continue to repent, Lord. We continue to walk it out. And then, Lord, I thank you for freedom right now in Jesus' name. I pray for freedom, Lord, in our hearts. Freedom to not be passive, but to be active in leaning into your purposes for us, Lord. Lord, I pray for those who have been, you've literally come here today, and as I've been speaking, you're reminded of just, Lord, when, Lord, when? Can I ask you, Lord, that you bring to our remembrance the ways and the areas that we still need to grow? Because you're placing stuff in us. Lord, you're more committed to the dreamer than you are to the dream. And so, Lord, I pray that you'd shape us. I pray, Lord, for City on Hill Church to be mature, lacking nothing, being fully formed into your image and likeness, Lord, living for your glory, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that love would abound, that faith would be our portion, and Lord, that we would be a people that when people look at our lives, they say the favor of God surrounds these people. They're going through ups and downs and they're walking out, but they're holding on to God's promises. They're representing God.